Today we are meeting William V, Baron Byron, the lordly predecessor and great uncle of the poet. Now, though the two never met because William had zero interest in his heir, his notorious misdeeds did feature in the poetry and even affected the love life of his more famous relative. In the 1830s, so long after his own death, William was branded the wicked Lord Byron, then the devil Byron, and then the mad Lord Byron, so it's not a great reputation. The 19th century myths declared that he was driven by violent rages, attempting to kill cousins, servants, and his wife for good measure. Also that he intentionally laid waste to his estate out of spite and spent the last 30 years as a bitter old recluse refusing to leave his ruined abbey. But what did he do to deserve this? Did he deserve this? William was born in 1722, the second child and much needed eldest son and heir of William IV Lord Byron and his wife Frances Barclay. And he inherited the family titles and estates, plus assets worth well over £1 million in modern money at the age of just 13. Sadly for him, he couldn't get at them or take his place in the House of Lords until his 21st birthday. So until then, he doodles about in the Navy, not achieving very much, before falling into a dodgy set of pleasure-loving and entitled aristocrat friends and spending much of his time at the races, oh, and also taking his own mother to court. In his early 20s, he promised to help in the fight against the Jacobite rebels. But then he promptly resigned and scurried straight back down to London as soon as the bloody battle that would be Culloden became imminent. According to a neighbour, by this time he already had a reputation for having a sad character in everything and particularly most shameful cowardice. So a quick highlight reel of just some of William's most wicked moments. At the same time as negotiating his marriage to a teenage heiress, he was pursuing a beautiful actress, Georgianne Bellamy. According to her, he even had her abducted and promised to fund a very glamorous lifestyle with his wife's money. Charming. He tried to cheat people out of their inheritances by convincing old women to write him into their wills instead, and then took their grieving relatives to court when he didn't get his way. He took out loans equating to millions in modern money, with absolutely no means of paying it back, and this was partly because he wanted to build his own fleet of replica warships to play with on his lake at Newstead Abbey. Most famously of all, he killed his lifelong neighbour and distant cousin William Chaworth in a stupidly petty dispute in a London tavern, stabbing him through the belly and then reportedly gloating, "By God, I have as much courage as any man in England." He was eventually confined to the Tower of London and subjected to a trial for murder. Having escaped the noose, he swaggered off on holiday, where he entertained himself with drinking, killing boar, flirting, and buying a ferocious wolf puppy. Eventually, his extravagant spending and holidaying meant that he had to sell off much of his lands and then strip the abbey virtually down to a skeleton in order to settle his debts. One thing that one of the auction catalogues reveals is that he also had a collection of animal specimens pickled in jars. So that is William, the fifth Lord Byron. He may not have been called the Wicked Lord in his own time, but if you do want some contemporary reviews, his own niece Sophie called him a great rogue, his mother-in-law took out a few lines in her actual will just to slag him off, and one former friend said, "One feels hostile to such a fellow as Lord Byron. Thank God we have few of these." Now check back soon for more on his truly terrible behaviour and to see how much of the myth about this supposedly murderous, wife-beating, Satan-worshipping orgy enthusiast are actually true. You're the devil in disguise, oh yes you are, devil in disguise, oh yes you are, devil in disguise, oh yes you are.